Hello students, my name is Dr. Zainab Atik. I am an endodontist. I will be discussing about a very important scenario that occurs in our day-to-day clinical practice, that is inter-appointment flare-up or endodontic flare-up. It can be of two types, that is mid-treatment flare-up or post-obturation flare-up. This incidence is as low as 1.6% to as high as 16% that causes distress to both the patient and the clinician. Today, I will be discussing about the definition, the criteria, the risk factors, that is patient-related, the diagnosis, the conditions of the systemic conditions, presenting signs and symptoms, treatment procedures, etiology, prevention, treatment, conclusion, and references. Now coming to introduction. Endodontic flare-up, it is described as the occurrence of pain, swelling, or both that occurs during the initiation of the root canal therapy that requires an unscheduled visit by the patient. Now coming to the definition, various journals have given the definition of endodontic flare-up. In Journal of Endodontics in 1992, it is defined as pain, swelling that requires an unscheduled patient visit and an active intervention by the dentist. Similar definition has been given by various other journals. Coming to the criteria, for the inter-appointment flare-up to occur, there has to be four major criteria, that is, first one, within a few hours to few days after a start of the endodontic procedure, the patient has significant increase in pain or swelling or the combination of the two. Second, it is of such a severe problem that the patient immediately contacts the dentist. Third one, then the dentist determines the problem and he schedules an unscheduled visit for the patient. Lastly, at the visit, active intervention is given. Now coming to risk factors. There are five major risk factors I shall be discussing about. The first one, patient related, that is demographic. Second one, the diagnosis. Third, systemic conditions. Fourth, depending upon the presenting signs and symptoms. Lastly, treatment procedures. First one, patient related. That is, it has been found that females have higher incidence of inter-appointment flare-up than males. It is due to the release of more amount of cortisol hormones in females. Second one, some journals have stated that age is not a significant factor in having greater or lesser amount of incidence of inter-appointment flare-up. Some other journals have stated that post-operative pain is more common among the young than the old. Second one, pulpal or periapical diagnosis. Teeth which have pulpal necrosis or acute apical abscess or periodontitis or the radiographic presence of larger periapical lesions, they all tend to cause increased amount of inter-appointment flare-up. When there is a sinus tract, there won't be any flare-up because it acts as a relief wall. Third one, systemic conditions. Allergies cause higher amount of inter-appointment flare-up than patients which are non-allergic to many materials that are used for the treatment. Systemic conditions like diabetes mellitus, they have an increased incidence of inter-appointment flare-up. Fourth one, presenting signs and symptoms. A patient that reports in pain is considerably more likely to experience a flare-up than a patient without prior symptoms. Or if the patient has a preoperative swelling, it leads to more amount for flare-up. Treatment procedures. This treatment procedure is under the control of the dentist. In retreatment cases, there is more chances of flare-up than the conventional root canal treatment. Single visit versus multiple visit. When the tooth is affected with the necrosis, then it is advised to do in a multiple visit root canal treatment. If it is done in single visit, the patient may face flare-up. If the canals are incompletely debrided, it may cause flare-up due to the remnants of the pulp. When obturation is done in severe signs and symptoms, that leads to an increased risk of flare-up. And it has been said by some journals that prophylactic antibiotics are not related to flare-up. And pre-treatment analgesics, they reduce the risk of flare-up. Now coming to the most important thing, etiology. The etiology of interappointment flare-up is multifactorial. It consists of a combination of microbial factors, host factors, and treatment procedures. Coming to the microbial factors, okay, the flare-ups that are attributed to microbial causes occur only if they are pathogenic and they have to be in sufficient numbers, and they should be more virulent in mixed cultures, and they should have ability to adapt themselves to a changed environment, and there should be difference in host susceptibility. Yes. This is the pathogenic species, the virulent cloning types, the high amount of cells, the microbial interactions, changes in the environmental, and decreased host susceptibility all lead to interappointment flare-up leading to pain. The bacteria, which is left behind in the isthmus, apical ramifications, irregularities, deltas, and tubules may be left untouched during cleaning and shaping of the root canals. Some may be sealed, killed, or prevented from gaining access to the apex by obturation. Okay, they have a wide variety of mechanisms for their survival. In cases of nitrogen depletion, oxygen depletion, low glucose concentration, as well as in phosphate starvation, the bacteria have many mechanisms to overcome these changed environment and cause flare-up. There are various bacteria that are seen in endodontic flare-up root canals, that is Bacteroides melanogenicus, Fusobacterium nucleatum, Enterococcus faecalis. This is the most important organism which is seen in failed root canal systems, failed root canal treatments, Actinomyces radicinitis, and other bacteria such as Parapyromonas species, Privotella, Peptostreptococcus species, Eubacterium, Porphyromonas endodontalis, Privotella species, etc. These all are seen in flare-up cases. Now, how do these microorganisms cause flare-up? There are four basic mechanisms in which they cause flare-up. That is, the first one is apical extrusion of infected debris. Second one, changes in the environmental conditions. Third one, secondary intraradicular infections. And lastly, increase of the oxidation reduction potential. We'll see one by one in detail. First one, apical extrusion of infected debris. It is known as the principal cause. When there is an asymptomatic chronic periradicular lesions, there is a balance between the microbial aggression and host defense. If the microbes gets extruded periapically during BMP or cleaning or shaping or chemomechanical preparation, this balance is disrupted. This leads to acute inflammation. When there is iatrogenic over-instrumentation with files during cleaning and shaping of the root canal, it leads to enlargement of the apical foramen. This leads to increased influx of exudates and blood into the root canal, which is also coupled with apical extrusion of infected debris. This leads to enhanced nutrient supply to the remaining bacteria. That leads to bacterial proliferation. That leads to exacerbation of a chronic periradicular lesion. When the virulent clonal types present in the root canal that extruded apically, a small amount of infected debris will have the potential to cause an exacerbation. So, to reduce this, crown down techniques are used to extrude less debris. The second one, okay, changes in the environmental conditions. In root canals, which has flare-ups or refractory cases or failed cases, there is dominance of gram-negative, facultative, and anaerobic bacteria. Whereas in untreated, untouched root canal cases, there is a dominance of gram-positive bacteria. And in the coronal portion, there is higher oxygen tension. So in these, facultatives and anaerobes are more dominant. Whereas in apical portion, it is the anaerobic condition of the area. So anaerobes predominate in this area. Irrigants and medicaments, they eliminate these bacterial communities. So chemomechanical preparation should be completed in one visit. And if you're doing in multiple visits, intracanal medicament should be placed. When there is incomplete chemomechanical preparation in the first visit, there is disruption of the balance within the microbial community. This eliminates some of the inhibitory species and it leaves behind previously inhibited species which overgrow and cause exacerbation. Coming to the third one, secondary intraradicular infections. Okay, this occurs in vital as well as necrotic tooth. It penetrates during the treatment or after the treatment. It occurs when aseptic chain is not followed, when it causes a breach in the aseptic chains. And the main sources of recontamination, as we all know, are remnants of plaque or calculus, caries on the tooth, leaking rubber dam, contaminated instruments, and irrigating solutions. The fourth one, increase in the oxidation reduction potential. Okay, alteration of this potential can be a major cause of interappointment flare-up. When the tooth is opened, the oxygen penetrates into the canal. The microbial pattern changes from anaerobic to aerobic. So the energy yield and growth rate is more marked in the presence of oxygen. Now, what happens? What are the important events that lead to interappointment flare-up? The main thing is acute inflammation that causes flare-up. It is a double-edged sword, meaning it protects the body from infections, and when the inflammatory products are higher, it also causes damage to the body. When the periradicular tissues are in chronic inflammation, the bacteria is faced with complement system, that is classic, alternative, and lectin. They activate these systems and the phagocytes engulfs the bacteria. This leads to increased vascular permeability, leading to increased hydrostatic pressure. This leads to outflow flow of the fluid, leading to accumulation in the extravascular space, leading to pain and swelling. Endothelium becomes leaky in inflammation due to formation of gaps, direct injury, or injury mediated by the leukocytes. When there is a bacteria that is encountered with a host defense mechanism, there is release of certain chemical mediators that leads to vascular changes. This recruits new macrophages to the site. When they are excessive, they cannot phagocytose large number of bacteria. This leading to leakage of lysosomes and oxygen-free radicals. This leads to pus formation, abscess, and endodontic flare-up. Allergens. Allergens such as sulfur products, pollen, dust, foodstuffs, they activate the IgE immunoglobulin that binds to the antigen. This causes the release of mast cell mediators such as histamine, leading to increased vascular permeability, leading to flare-up. Now, all these physical, bacterial, and chemical factors, they all lead to tissue damage, leading to inflammation, leading to chemical mediators, causing transudate or exudate, leading to pain and or swelling. Now, coming to host factors, the main causes we have seen are by the microbial factors. This is the second one. Host plays an important role in causing flare-up. There are two mechanisms: alteration of the local adaptation syndrome and changes in the periapical tissue pressure. First one, alteration of the local adaptation syndrome. It was introduced by Sale in 1953. He says that in chronic inflammation, the periapical tissue gets adapted to the irritant. When the endodontic treatment is started, new irritants are introduced in the periapical area, leading to violent reaction, causing liquefactive necrosis, leading to severe pain and swelling. Changes in the periapical tissue pressure. When there is increased periapical pressure, there are excessive exudates that are not absorbed by the lymphatics. So there is pressure on the nerve endings leading to pain. When there is decreased periapical pressure, the microorganisms may be aspirated into the periapex area and it may not drain, leading to flare-up. Now coming to the third important factor, that is the treatment procedures, which is in hand of the dentist. When there's inadequate debridement, there's presence of residual pulp tissue that allows bacteria and their toxins to remain in the root canal and thereby teeth with necrotic pulps are more prone for mid-treatment flare-ups than vital pulp. So thorough debridement is the main goal of initial management of a treatment. Intracanal medicaments and obturating materials may act as antigens, producing exaggerated response, and they cause pain. Chemicals that are used as intracanal medicaments and irrigants such as sodium hypochlorite, hydrogen peroxide, etc., they induce a hypersensitivity reaction that causes pain and swelling. Irrigant extrusion. Commonly used irrigants are sodium hypochlorite, which has an excellent antimicrobial efficiency. It has the ability to resorb necrotic as well as vital tissue. When it is extruded beyond the apex, it leads to exacerbation of the pain, swelling, and hematoma, resulting in ulceration and tissue necrosis. Now, how do we prevent endodontic flare-up? There are two ways. First one is technique related and the second one is systemic measures. Now we will see technique related steps. First one, instrumentation technique. Linear filing motion have known to cause a greater amount of debris periapically. So crown down technique with copious and frequent irrigation, they extrude lesser debris than linear filing motion. Chemomechanical preparation should be completed in single visits. When it is a non-vital tooth, it should be completed in multiple visits. Intracanal medicaments, they deny space for bacterial proliferation, thus preventing recontamination. The medicaments to be used should be non-toxic and it should not get extruded periapically. Occlusal reduction is ineffective mostly, but it is effective in teeth which have pain upon mastication. And the teeth shouldn't be left open for drainage. Establishment of drainage followed by complete chemomechanical preparation, followed by placement of an intracanal medicament and closure at the same appointment, this leads to reduced risk of flare-up. When there is diffuse swelling also, please do not leave the teeth open because there'll be more ingress of the microbial cells. Following a strict aseptic change will prevent flare-ups. Now coming to systemic measures, antibiotics. Prophylactic antibiotics, they are unrelated to the incidence of flare-up. It is contraindicated as a preventive measure. Analgesics do reduce the incidence of flare-ups and it depends on the patient's presenting conditions. Now, apical extrusion of infected debris, it can be prevented by using crown down instrumentation techniques with copious and frequent irrigation. Changes in environmental conditions can be prevented by completion of a chemomechanical preparation in a single visit. Secondary intraradicular infection can be prevented by following strict aseptic measures. And alteration of the oxidation reduction potential can be prevented by placement of an intracanal medicament in between appointments. Now, coming to the treatment, what if the flare-up occurs? What do we need to do? We should follow 3 D's, that is diagnosis, definitive treatment, and lastly, the drugs. Coming to diagnosis, we should rule out the conditions that mimic endodontic pain, and thorough understanding of the chief complaint and thorough clinical examination should be done. Coming to definitive treatment, first one, re-instrumentation. The involved tooth should be properly anesthetized before re-instrumentation with enhanced illumination and magnification. The working lens should be re-established. There may be suppurative exudation that leads to reduces the localized tissue pressure, and a closed dressing should be given thereafter. Second one, cortical trepanation. This is the surgical perforation of the alveolar bone in an attempt to relieve the accumulated periradicular tissue exudate within the apex. But many studies have reported that the patients felt no relief in symptoms with cortical trepanation. Third one, incision and drainage. If abscess occurs after obturation, then incision of the fluctuant tissue is done, provided if the obturation is good. If the obturation is not good, in addition to incision, filling material should be removed for additional pus drainage. Fourth one, use, as we have seen, use of intracanal medicaments, it reduces post-treatment pain. Now, treatment of flare-ups in vital pulp. In vital pulp, flare-ups seldom occurs. It may occur due to pulpal remnants that become necrotic and they are invaded by the bacteria. Treatment is the same. Working length is re-established, copious irrigation with sodium hypochlorite, intracanal medicament, and closed dressing. If not, these cases are managed with incision and drainage. Necrotic pulp without swelling. In this, the tooth is opened, the canal is instrumented, irrigated with sodium hypochlorite. Occasionally, there will be drainage. The canals are then re-irrigated, dried, and intracanal medicament is placed and the access is sealed. Drainage from the tooth did not result in significant reduction in pain as compared to no drainage, according to a study. In necrotic pulp cases with swelling, the tooth are opened, canals re-dried and closed. If there are symptoms of severe signs of infection, there should be hospitalized and extraoral drainage should be done. Coming to drugs, as we have seen, antibiotics are of no importance in treatment of flare-up. The antibiotic recommendations are, in vital pulp and in necrosis cases, it is not recommended. When there is a periapical abscess, it can be localized or spreading. If it's localized also, antibiotics are not recommended. It is recommended only if the patient is medically compromised. If it is spreading, antibiotic is given, amoxicillin 500 mg. If the condition resolves, it is fine. If it does not resolve, switch to clindamycin and consider the culture and sensitivity test. If it deteriorates, please consider the patient referral to surgical specialist. Non-narcotic analgesics such as NSAIDs, acetaminophen, ibuprofen, ketoprofen, all are helpful in the treatment of interappointment flare-up. If the flare-up is very severe, then opioid analgesics come into play. Tramadol is very effective in managing emergency pain. And COX-2 inhibitors, according to theory, rofecoxib, but it is not used nowadays. Now, in post-obturation emergencies, which is of very mild level, active intervention is seldom necessary. Reassurance with mild analgesics will help. Now, when the flare-up is managed, the patient should be followed up until the symptoms subside. Patients with severe or persistent problems and requiring additional measures should have follow-up appointments and additional treatment whenever needed. If not, periapical surgery should be considered. Okay, I hereby conclude that because microorganisms are arguably the major causative agents for flare-up, knowledge about the microbial mechanisms involved in the etiology of endodontic flare-up is of utmost importance. Flare-ups are an undesirable occurrence in the course of endodontic treatment that causes distress to both the clinician and the patient. The clinician should therefore employ proper measures in an attempt to prevent the incidence of flare-up and should be able to treat it effectively when they do occur. These are my references. Thank you. Thanks a lot.